What a fellowship, what a joy divine, leaning on the everlasting arms. What a blessedness, what a peace is mine, leaning on the everlasting arms. Well, I'm leaning, oh, I'm leaning, safe and secure from all alarms. Well, I'm leaning, oh, I'm leaning, I'm leaning on the everlasting arms. Oh, how sweet to walk in this pilgrim way, leaning on the everlasting arms. Oh, how bright the path grows from day to day, leaning on the everlasting arms. We're leaning, we're leaning, safe and secure from all alarms. We're leaning, I'm leaning, I'm leaning on the everlasting arms. And what have I to dread? What have I to fear? I'm leaning on the everlasting arms. I have blessed peace with my Lord so near. I'm leaning on his everlasting arms. Well, I'm leaning, oh, I'm leaning, I'm safe and secure from all alarms. I'm leaning, I'm leaning, I'm leaning on the everlasting arms. Well, I'm leaning, oh, I'm leaning, I'm safe and secure from all alarms. Oh, I'm leaning, oh, I'm leaning, I'm leaning on the everlasting arms. I keep falling in love with him over and over and over and over again. I keep falling in love with him over and over and over and over again. He gets sweeter and sweeter as the days go by. Oh, what a love between my Lord and I. I keep falling in love with him over and over and over and over again, again. I keep falling in love with him over and over and over and over again. I keep falling in love with him over and over and over and over again. He gets sweeter and sweeter as the days go by. Oh, what a love between my Lord and I. I keep falling in love with him over and over and over and over again. Blessing. He keeps blessing me over and over and over and over and over again. He keeps blessing me over and over and over and over and over again. He gets sweeter and sweeter as the days go by. Oh, what a love between my Lord and I. I keep falling in love with him over and over and over and over again. Cleansing. He keeps cleansing me over and over and over and over and over again. Oh, he keeps cleansing me over and over and over and over and falling in love with him over and over and over and over again. Jesus, my heavenly King, loves me, I know. Praises to him I sing, onward I go. Closely to him I cling, blessings still flow. I love my Savior too. I love my Savior. He loves me too.
Yes, he loves me too.
And I seek his favor in everything I do. And walking with him each day, love light does shine. Doing his will always, never repine. Kneeling to him I pray, thy will, not mine. I love my Savior too. I love my Savior. He loves me too.
Yes, he loves me too.
I seek his favor in everything I do. I'm happy to serve my friend, lean on his arm. Rapture will never end, nothing alarm. Those voices will sweetly blend under his charm. And I love my Savior too. I love my Savior. He loves me.
Yes, he loves me too.
And I seek his favor in everything I do. I love my Savior, and he loves me too.
Yes, he loves me too.
I seek his favor in everything I do. I know it was the blood, oh Lord. I know it was the blood, my Jesus. I know it was the blood for me. And I know it was the blood for me. He never said a mumbling word, my Lord. He never said a mumbling word, oh Jesus, my. He never said a mumbling word for me. I know it was the blood for me. Then they nailed him to the cross. Oh, they nailed him to the cross, my Lord. They nailed him to the cross for me. I know it was the blood for me. The blood came streaming down. The blood came streaming down. That blood, the blood came streaming down for me.
For me.
Oh, and one day he died upon the cross. I know,
and I know it was the blood for me.
Then he hung his head and died. He died.
He hung his head and died.
All for me.
He hung his head and died for me. And one day when I was lost, he died upon the cross.
I know,
and I know it was the blood for me.
I know, and I know it was the blood for me. Let us sing. There's a happy land of promise over in the great beyond, where the saved of earth shall soon the glory share, and where the souls of men shall enter and live on forevermore. Everybody will be happy over there. Now everybody will be happy, we will be happy over there. We will shout and sing his praise. Now everybody will be happy over there. And there the ransomed of all ages will be singing round the throne, in that land where no one ever knows a care. And the Christians of all nations will join in the triumph song. Everybody will be happy over there. Now everybody will be happy. We will be happy over there. We will shout and sing God's praise. Now everybody will be happy over there. There we'll meet the one who saved us and who kept us by his grace, and who brought us to that land so bright and fair. We will praise his name forever as we look upon his face. Now everybody will be happy. I keep falling in love with him over and over and over and over again. I keep falling in love with him over and over and over and over again. He gets sweeter and sweeter as the days go by. Oh, what a love between my Lord and I. I keep falling in love with him over and over and over and over again. I keep falling in love with him over and over and over and over again. I keep falling in love with him over and over and over and over again. He gets sweeter and sweeter as the days go by. Oh, what a love between my Lord and I. I keep falling in love with him over and over and over and over again. Blessing. He keeps blessing me over and over and over and over and over again. He keeps blessing me over and over and over and over and over again. He gets sweeter and sweeter as the days go by. Oh, what a love between my Lord and I. I keep falling in love with him over and over and over and over again. cleansing.
He keeps cleansing me over and over and over and over and over again.
Oh, he keeps cleansing me over and over and over and over and over again.
He gets sweeter and sweeter as days go by. Oh, what a love between my Lord and I. I keep falling in love with him over and over and over and over again.
Jesus, my heavenly King, loves me, I know. Praises to him I sing, onward I go. Closely to him I cling, blessings still flow. I love my Savior too. Oh, I love my Savior.
He loves me too. Yes, he loves me too.
And I seek his favor in everything I do. And walking with him each day, love light does shine. Doing his will always, never repine. Kneeling to him I pray, thy will, not mine.
Oh,
I love my Savior too. I love my Savior. He loves me too.
Yes, he loves me too.
I seek his
favor
in everything I do. I'm happy to serve my friend, lean on his arm. Rapture will never end, nothing alarm. Those voices will sweetly blend under his charm. And I love my Savior too. I love my
Savior. Yes, he loves me too.
And I seek his
favor
in everything I do. I love my
Savior,
and he loves me too.
Yes, he loves me too.
I seek his favor in everything I do. I know it was the blood, oh Lord. I know it was the blood, my Jesus. I know it was the blood for me. Oh, and one day when I was lost, he died upon the cross. And I know it was the blood for me. He never said a mumbling word, my Lord. He never said a mumbling word, oh Jesus, my. He never said a mumbling word for me. Oh, and one day when I was lost, he died upon the cross. I know it was the blood for me. When they nailed him to the cross, oh, they nailed him to the cross, my Lord. They nailed him to the cross for me. I know
it was the blood for me. The blood came streaming down.
The blood came streaming down.
That blood, the blood came streaming down for me.
Let us sing. There's a happy land of promise over in the great beyond, where the saved of earth shall soon the glory share, and where the souls of men shall enter and live on forevermore. Everybody will be happy over there. Now everybody will be happy, we will be happy over there. We will shout and sing his praise. Now everybody will be happy over there. And there the ransomed of all ages will be singing round the throne, in that land where no one ever knows a care. And the Christians of all nations will join in the triumph song. Everybody will be happy over there. Now everybody will be happy. We will be happy over there. We will shout and sing God's praise. Now everybody will be happy over there. There we'll meet the one who saved us and who kept us by his grace, and who brought us to that land so bright and fair. We will praise his name forever as we look upon his face. Now everybody will be happy over there. Now everybody will be happy. We will be happy over there. We will shout and sing praise. Now everybody will be happy over there. Now everybody will be happy. We will be happy over there. Now we will shout and sing God's praise. Everybody will be happy over there.
My only hope is you, Jesus. My only hope is you. From early in the morning till late at night, my only hope is you. My only hope.
at night. My only hope is you. My only peace is you. My only peace is you. My Jesus, my only peace is you. And from early in the morning to late at night, my only peace is you. My only joy is you. My only joy is you. Oh Jesus, my only joy is you. Oh, from early in the morning to late at night, oh, my only joy is you. All that I need is you. All that I need is you. My Jesus, all that I need is you. Oh, from early in the morning to late at night, all that I need is you. And my only hope is you. Oh, Jesus, my only hope is you. And from early in the morning to late at night, my only hope is you. From early in the morning to late at night, my only hope is you. From early in the morning to late at night, my only hope is you.
Good morning, church. Welcome this morning. Our invocation will be read from Psalms 100, verses 1 through 5. That is Psalms 100, verses 1 through 5, and it reads, "Shout for joy to the Lord of all the earth. Worship the Lord with gladness. Come before him with joyful songs. Know that the Lord is God. It is he who made us, and we are his. We are his people, the sheep of the pasture. Enter his gates with thanksgiving, and his courts with praise. Give thanks to him and praise his name. For the Lord is good, and his love endures forever. His faithfulness continues through all generations." Bow for prayer, please. Heavenly Father, we thank you so very much for this day, that we can come and commune with you, so that we can hear your word to improve our lives. We thank you for all the blessings that you give us each and every day, and that you look out for us and you help us through our challenges and sickness. We give thanks that you will bless this church, bless our visitors, bless all those who are interested in your word, and bring them to us. Thank you, Heavenly Father. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
There's a message true and glad for the sinful and the sad. Bring it out, bring it out. It will give them courage new. It will help them to be true. Ring it out, ring it out. Ring out the word, o'er land and sea. Still far from Jesus, many live in sin and doubt. Ring out the word that makes men free. To all the lost of every nation, ring it, ring it out. Tell the world of saving grace, make it known in every place. Ring it out, ring it out. Help the needy ones to know him from whom our blessings flow. Ring it out, ring it out. Ring out the word, or land and sea. Still far from Jesus, many live in sin and doubt. Ring out the news that makes men free. To all the lost of every nation, ring it, ring it out. Sin and doubt to sweep away, till shall dawn the better day. Ring it out, ring it out. Till the sinful world be won, for Jehovah's mighty Son. Ring it out, ring it out. Ring out the word, o'er land and sea. Still far from Jesus, many live in sin and doubt. Ring out the news that makes men free. To all the lost of every nation, ring it out. Ring out the word, o'er land and sea. Still far from Jesus, many live in sin and doubt. Ring out the news that makes men free. To all the lost of every nation, ring it out. Amen. Our next selection is 699. I'll Be a Friend to Jesus. If we have it, let us all together sing. They tried my Lord and Master, with no one to live, no one to defend. Within the halls, within the halls of highness, he stood without, he stood without a friend. I'll be a friend to Jesus.
My life for him,
my life for him I'll spend.
I'll be a friend,
I'll be a friend to Jesus.
Until my
years shall end. The world may turn, the world may turn against him. I'll love him too, I'll love him to the end. And while on earth, and while on earth I'm living, my Lord shall have, my Lord shall have a friend.
Yes, Lord.
I'll be a friend to Jesus.
My life for him,
my life for him I'll spend.
I'll
be a friend to Jesus.
Until my
years shall end. To all who need, to all who need a Savior, my friend I reck, my friend I reck, come in. Because
because he brought salvation is why I am his friend. Yes, Lord,
I'll be a friend
to Jesus. My life for him I've spent.
I'll be a friend
to Jesus until my year shall end.
Amen.
Good morning, church. I am here before you with today's scripture reading and prayer. Today's scripture will be taken from Genesis chapter 40, verses 1 through 8, where the Bible reads, "Sometime after this, the butler of the king of Egypt and his baker offended their lord, the king of Egypt. And Pharaoh was angry with his two officers, the chief butler and the chief baker, and he put them in custody in the house of the captain of the guard, in the prison where Joseph was confined. The captain of the guard charged Joseph with them, and he waited on them. And they continued for some time in custody. And one night they both dreamed. The butler and the baker of the king of Egypt, who were confined in the prison, each his own dream, and each dream with its own meaning. When Joseph came to them in the morning and saw them, they were troubled. So he asked Pharaoh's officers who were with him in custody in his master's house, 'Why are your faces downcast today?' They said to him, 'We have had dreams, and there is no one to interpret them.' And Joseph said to them, 'Do not interpretations belong to God? Tell them to me, I pray you.'" May the Lord add a blessing to the hearers, the believers, and the doers of his word. And may you bow with me now for a word of prayer. Holy Father of God, we come before you humbly approaching your throne, thanking you for all that you have created, thanking you for each and every opportunity that you've given us to come before you with worship and with praise. Father, we just pray that you be with each and every one of us, that we be united together in worship, and though we be separated at this time. We pray that you will bless us so that your spirit will come to each of us and that you will be with us, Father God, as we worship and praise you. Father, we pray that you be with Leonard Bradley and his family. We pray that you bless him and his wife, his children. We pray that you be over his home and that you be over him and his life, that you bless him and all that he does, that he will continue to lead this congregation. Father, we pray that you bless the word that has been given to him, that he will deliver it into us in a way where we can understand it. We pray that you will open our hearts and our minds, that we will accept your word, and that we will apply it to our lives. Father, we just pray that your word will forever change us every time we hear it and every time we accept it. Father, we just pray that you be with all those who have contracted coronavirus and the many families that have been affected by it. We pray that you continue to be with those who are administering the vaccine. We pray that you will bless us so that we can come out of this pandemic. We pray that you will continue to be a protector, a provider, and that you will continue to bless us so that we will do your will. Forgive us for our sins and our shortcomings and the things that we do which are contrary to your will and your way. Father God, just bless us this day and bless this worship, that all things which are done and said will be done in a manner pleasing and acceptable unto you. For it's in Jesus Christ's name we pray and thank you. Amen.
We will glorify the King of Kings. We will glorify the Lamb. We will glorify the Lord of Lords, who is the great I Am. Lord Jehovah reigns in majesty. We will bow before his throne. We will worship him in righteousness. We will worship him alone. He is Lord of heaven, Lord of earth. He is Lord of all who live. He is Lord above the universe. All praise to him we give. Oh, hallelujah to the King of Kings. Hallelujah to the Lamb. Hallelujah to the Lord of Lords, who is the great I am.
But it is they call him Jesus. He came to love, heal, and forgive. He lived and died to buy my pardon. An empty grave is there to prove my Savior lives. Because he lives, I can face tomorrow. Because he lives, all fear is gone. Because I know he holds the future, and life is worth the living just because he lives. How sweet to hold a newborn baby and feel the pride and joy he gives. But greater still, the calm assurance this child can face uncertain days because he lives. Because he lives, I can face tomorrow. Because he lives, all fear is gone. Because I know, oh, he holds the future, and life is worth the living just because he lives. And then one day I'll cross the river, I'll fight my the woe and pain, and then as death gives way to victory, I'll see the light of glory, and I'll know he lives. Because he lives, I can face tomorrow. Because he lives, all fear is gone. Because I know, oh, he holds the future, and life is worth the living just because he lives.
We come now to the portion of the service known as the communion. The communion is inextricably tied to the gospel. The historical facts are that the perfect God created man. Man sinned by disobedience in the garden and became exceedingly more sinful until the fullness of time that the Word of God came to earth as a man and was crucified for our sins, bearing our sins in his home body. Our perfect Lord and Savior loved us so much that he became the antithesis of his very existence in order to save us. We commemorate the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ by the symbols that he gave us the night that he was betrayed by Judas. The bread, representing the broken body, the cup, representing the blood that he spilled on the cross, establishing the covenant of grace and truth to all who believe. Shall we bow? Dear God, we understand that your word carried out your will in the creation and carried out your will in providing salvation to mankind. I pray that we realize the tremendous sacrifice that you made on our behalf and receive these symbols with the reverence due our Lord and Savior. It is in his name we pray. Amen.
And then one day, across the river, I'll fight life's fight, the woe and pain. And then as death gives way to victory, I'll see the light of glory and I'll know he reigns.
We come now to the portion of the service known as the contribution. Returning a portion of our prosperity to God, we know has been a part of our existence since Cain and Abel. Abraham's gift to Melchizedek exemplified the practice of giving one-tenth of one's prosperity that was codified in the law of Moses. We, having much better promises for salvation, are commanded by Christ and the apostles to give as we prosper. Please search your hearts and give back to the Lord a portion of your prosperity. Shall we bow? Most high and holy God in heaven, we pray that you please bless this collection that we have taken up. Dear God, bless the hands of those who will be administering these funds, that they do so in all ways pleasing and acceptable to you, and that the result of their efforts will be an increase in the spread of your word, an increase in the edification of the saints. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Let us sing. There's not a friend like the lowly Jesus, singing, oh, not one. No, not one, and none else could heal all our souls' diseases. Singing, no, not one, no, not one. I'll tell you, Jesus knows all about our struggles, and he will guide till the day is done. And there's not a friend like the lowly Jesus, singing, oh, not one, no, not one. And no friend like him is so high and holy, singing, no, not one, singing, no, not one. And yet no friend is so meek and lowly, singing, no, not one, oh, no, not one. And Jesus knows all about our struggles, and he will guide till the day is done. And there's
not a friend like the lowly Jesus. Singing, no, not one. Singing, no, not one. And there's not an hour that he is not near us. Singing, no, not one. Oh, no, not one. And no night so dark, but his love can cheer us. Singing, no, not one. Singing, no, not one. I'll tell you, Jesus knows all about our struggles, and he will guide till the day is done. And there's not a friend like the lowly Jesus. Singing, no, not one. Oh, no, not one.
Good morning, Cypress family. We are so thankful to you and thankful to the Lord for bringing us together in this service today. As we move through this new year, 2021, we are blessed and we thank God for all of his goodness and grace towards us, for the blessings he's bestowed on us. And we pray that he continues to bless your lives. We are hoping that all is well with you and your families here at Cypress and across the country and other places where those of you who are joining in to be with us, we're grateful to welcome you and to have you in with us on this Lord's Day morning. We want to focus again in the book of Genesis. We're working through the life of Joseph. And the study is a fascinating study in so many ways. I just want to begin to focus today in Genesis chapter 40. We came through chapter 39 in our last message. This time, we want to focus in chapter 40. We may get into parts of 41. The paragraphs are so extensive, but they cover relevant information, important information. And I'm praying that all of us will be able to benefit and to gain what we need to understand in order for the Lord to be more effectively working in our own personal lives. And so if you will, join with me in Genesis chapter 40. We'll read to verse number 7, and then we'll launch into our message for today. Sometime after this, the butler of the king of Egypt and his baker offended their lord, the king of Egypt, and Pharaoh was angry with his two officers, the chief butler and the chief baker. And he put them in custody in the house of the captain of the guard, in the prison where Joseph was confined. The captain of the guard charged Joseph with them, and he waited on them, and they continued for some time in custody. And one night they both dreamed, the butler and the baker, of the king of Egypt, who were confined in the prison, each his own dream, and each dream with its own meaning. When Joseph came to them in the morning and saw them, they were troubled. And so he asked Pharaoh's officers, who were with him in custody in the master's house, why are your faces downcast today? They said to him, we have had dreams, and there is no one to interpret them. And Joseph said to them, do not interpretations belong to God? Tell me, I pray you. And so from this paragraph or this portion of scripture, I want to use for a topic, dreams of leaders deferred. Dreams of leaders deferred. deferred because, as we read in our story, the baker, the butler and the baker were downhearted. Their hearts were down. They were troubled. They were sorry because, as the text says, there is no one to interpret our dreams, which meant that they were not going to be able to get an understanding of what the dreams meant. Obviously, they were understanding that those dreams had some kind of meaning in their lives. But as they understood those dreams having meaning in their lives, they needed someone to tell them what they meant. And being in prison, of course, you can't get out into the country or out into the city to find someone who can help you with that in that time. So they were downcast. But Joseph, who he was, made the difference in that he was very attentive to their needs, as he had been, as we learn even here, that he waited on them. And we'll talk about that in a minute. But nonetheless, Joseph was there. And as Joseph was there, he understood that he could had an inroad and an opportunity to open up this door to tell them what their dreams were all about. And remember, his motive is simply to pick up their spirits. But let's get into the thought. And I want to just put this out there in the beginning, and I'll say this as a guiding idea. I want us to see what's happening here. And in these stories, in these verses, I want to say that the power of God's providence is at work in our lives to bring about his will in our lives. The ability to know that God is present in your life requires careful submission in faith to the spirit of humility. Humility opens the heart to service and care for others at self-expense. I don't know that there's another character in this story that displays humility like Joseph. But humility is also the path where patience and perseverance find their strength to see God move in a disciplined life. Joseph lived a disciplined life, focused on no more than being faithful to the Lord, as the Lord was faithful to him. And there is no greater probability of success than to know the Lord and to lift him up in your life with every opportunity as you serve others in the process. And so I want to just talk just a bit, a moment, understanding that idea of providence, dreams of leaders deferred. The presence and providence of the Lord is significant in these verses, in this story. And the very interesting thing is that God is generally in the picture, but he's one of those pictures, you know, like how you have to stare at for a time in a certain way, and then after you stare at them for so long in a certain way, another image begins to appear, and you see that image there, and you say, oh, there's some depth to what's going on here. And so it is, even in this story with Joseph. There's some depth going on, and God is in the scene, in the picture. Because providence means that he is actively engaged in human affairs, sovereignly engaged, over it all, not really interfering, but leaving everyone with their own decisions to make. And so as we think about this providence idea, when we started the series, Joseph, in 37 and 5:11, Joseph considered the meaning of his dreams and what they would mean for his life. Now he has progressed to where he interprets dreams of others at the appropriate time. In this case, the dreamers are leaders who are anxious to know what they have dreamed made known to them. Through these events, we continue to see how God is openly at work in the world to bring his plans to life for man. He is sovereign, meaning that he is the Lord. He is King of Kings. He is over all, doing what he will in the interest of his creation without interfering with the choices and decisions we make for ourselves. Very important that God leaves us to be free human agents to make choices. But he also has choices that he would like for us to make, that he will not interfere with us because he loves us and he wants us to love him in return. But that said, understand, whatever the Lord pleases, as the psalmist says in Psalm 135 and 5, whatever the Lord pleases, he does in heaven and on earth, in the seas and all deeps. Daniel 4:35, later on, and Daniel, of course, looking at Nebuchadnezzar, but Nebuchadnezzar spoke giving praise and glory to God in this way, saying he lives forever, for his dominion is an everlasting dominion, and his kingdom endures from generation to generation. All the inhabitants of the earth are accounted as nothing, and he does according to his will in the host of heaven and among the inhabitants of the earth, and none can stay his hand or say to him, what are you doing? Joseph was good about putting others first. It was a quality that he had in his character. It helped get him into conversation with the butler and the baker who were put in the same prison, mind you, placed in the same prison where Joseph was being held. We look to see where we can find God moving in the lives of these leaders. Just so happens that the butler and the baker were, of course, servants in the court of Pharaoh. They were two high officers thrown in prison because they offended the king. The chief butler and the chief baker of Pharaoh's court are thrown in with Joseph. And Joseph, the Bible says in 40 in verse number one, and he put them in custody of the house of the captain of the guard in the prison where Joseph was confined. And the captain charged Joseph with them, and he waited on them. And they continued for some time in custody. So he had time to spend time, to get to know them, to pay attention, to understand who they were. How does this happen? These two guys, officers in the king's court, they were over something. One was the cupbearer and one was the baker. But the cupbearer was the one who drank the wine, if you will, to make sure there was no poison in it for the king. I'll just leave it like that for right now. And the baker, of course, was someone who worked in the preparation for food for the king or Pharaoh. The chief butler and the baker are here. And in the Bible, we need to understand that as they meet Joseph, they have in this very same setting, the butler and the baker of the king confined, each had his own dream. Two dreams, one night. In this one night, these dreams were so vividly displayed for them that they were troubled the next day. And so here we find Joseph coming to their assistant and saying to them, let me hear. And as he does, he says, do not interpretations belong to God? Only Joseph would know such a thing. But in the Bible, God uses dreams to communicate with men, especially in the patriarch time. The Bible shows us two kinds of dreams. The first are the dreams which communicate a message from God. Genesis 20, 3 and 7, 1 Kings 3, 5, Matthew 1, 20. God was needing to speak and did speak, and he used the medium of dreams. And understand that this is just one of the ways that God communicates. And it was a way that he communicated then. He doesn't necessarily communicate the same way now, because he doesn't need to in the same way. I listened to the Hebrew writer. Let me just read this for you real quick as we plow through this idea of dreams. I don't want anyone to get confused about the notion. You know, there are some charlatans out there that believe that God is making them to see things and understand things through their dreams. And maybe messages do come through dreams, but they're not always the voice of God in the same way. Hear the Bible in Hebrews chapter 1,
in many and various ways, God, in many and various ways, God spoke of old to our fathers by the prophets, but in these last days has spoken to us by a Son whom he appointed heir of all things. There's no need to try to find message in dreams that God is not intending for us to know. But in this story, we learn that these Egyptians, the butler and the baker, were perplexed about what it is that they dreamed, and they needed to know because their dream was deferred. And so here we understand. Second, there is another way, another kind of dream that comes. And that dream, those dreams are, there is an ordinary dream, occurrences in which the sleeper sees a connected series of pictures which corresponds to the events of everyday life. You know, I have dreams like that sometimes, but, you know, I don't necessarily make sense of it all, and I don't, you know, necessarily want to try to make sense of it all. Sometimes you just want them to go away. But nonetheless, here in this case, the dreamers needed an interpreter. And until they got the interpreter, they were distraught, they were saddened, they were disappointed. Without the interpreter, they could not see the meaning of their dreams. The two of them dreamt the same night, one the next, and on the next day, Joseph sees that they're down. And then Joseph leans in for them to tell him their dreams. And just understand Deuteronomy 13:1-5, Jeremiah 23:25-32. Understand that God warns us about dreams and how that we need to be careful about dreams. But in this sense, and I believe as we read Deuteronomy 13:1-5, we need to understand that in this sense, Joseph is serving as a prophet. Because he interprets what God has communicated in the dream of the baker and the butler. But there's something unique about their dreams. Their dreams are about something that has not happened yet and will take place in the future. And so, as we understand, if you know anything about God and you know anything about prophecy and dreams, refer to Deuteronomy 13:1-5. If you know anything about this understanding, then you know that the only one who knows the future is God himself. No wonder they can't understand what they're dreaming. And we'll find out that even Pharaoh, we'll talk about Pharaoh, we'll understand that even Pharaoh could not understand his dream. And all the magicians and all the men that he brought, the wise men that he brought into his court, could not tell him what his dream meant, because no man can predict the future. Only God understands the future. Only God knows what's ahead. Only God can see the end from the beginning and the beginning from the end, because he is sovereign Lord. So when we understand that, you know, there's nothing more that can bring you to a place of humility than to understand that you are powerless in the hands of a mighty and great and wonderful God. And so it is. God gave Joseph, the Bible says, the ability to interpret dreams. 40 in verse number 8, Genesis. Let me just get back there real quick. That's why Joseph says that. You know, it's beautiful that Joseph is keen enough to understand it. It's beautiful that Joseph doesn't try to take credit for himself to say something that, you know, God gave him to say. Do not interpretations belong to the Lord? 41 in verse number 12. He goes there even with Pharaoh. If we listen to him again, the Bible says, well, I don't want to get ahead of my story here, but I'm not sure I'm going to get through all this today, but we'll just hang on to that thought for just a minute. And so the butler's dream is this. He sees the whole process, and I'm going to summarize it. You know, the butler's dream, let me get back over here to this verse here. The butler's dream, you know, he sees this thing happen just right in front of him in his dream. And I guess you can wonder, you know, making wine is a process. You can't just throw wine together. If you want a good wine, you know, a savory wine, you know, one of them, you can roll around, you can breathe and roll around. I don't know about all that. Jesus made the best wine in the world, you know, out of a pot of water. Probably the best wine, didn't have to go through all that process either. But in this dream, the butler, You know, the wine taster, he's also the cupbearer. He's also a eunuch in some degree. You know, the official of the king's court. Just throwing it out there for those of you who are paying attention. And so we understand that here, verse 9, the butler told his dream to Joseph and said to him, in my dream, there was a vine before me. I don't want to read all that. The vine before me. And on the vine, there were three branches. As soon as it budded, its blossoms shot forth and the clusters ripened into grapes. And so he's telling us that he sees the process of winemaking in just a matter of seconds. That's what dreams do. Dreams take things and put them in different fashion. You know, so it looks real funny. We don't understand what's going on, but it's happening in the dream. It doesn't make sense in a lot of ways, but here it is. He sees the bud. He sees the branches. He sees the blossoms, ripened grape, gathered, pressed, poured in Pharaoh's cup. The cupbearer serves the wine to Pharaoh. And so he asked Joseph, well, now, the outcome of his dream, Joseph declares to him, he says, this is its interpretation. In the three branches are 3 days. There you have 3 days. Within 3 days, the days that are to come, it's a future picture. It hasn't happened, but it's coming. Within 3 days, Pharaoh will lift up your head and restore you to your office, and you shall place Pharaoh's cup in his hand, and as formerly when you were his butler. 14. So he tells him exactly what's going to happen. And so, you know, and as he tells him what's going to happen, so the dreams involve the events. The king, just to give you a little backdrop, you know, ancient kings, the birthday was a national holiday for the king. And they had celebrations. And when they had these celebrations, they used them for showing special kindness to certain prisoners and dealing with others severely. So they would show favor to one and deal severely with another. This was just something, you know, I'm throwing a birthday party, you know, show up at your own risk or show up at your own, your own blessing, one way or the other. But you had two guys in prison, the baker and the butler, or the butler and the baker, whichever way you want to put it, bees are there, but there they are. And as they are there, we understand the king's birthday, 40 and verse number 20, and Joseph's master took him and put him into the prison. No, I'm sorry, wrong verse. And on the third day, it says, on the third day, here's the interpretation, chapter 40, verse 20. And on the third day, which was Pharaoh's birthday, he made a feast for all of his servants and lifted up the head of the chief butler. So he lifts up the head of the chief butler and the head of the baker among his servants. There's a lot of wordplay going on. I don't have time to explain it all. There's a lot going on. But the baker and the butler, his servants. And it says in verse 21, he restored the chief butler to his butlership. So the butler gets restored. And he placed the cup in Pharaoh's hand, just like Joseph said. And it says, but he hanged the chief baker. And what that means is that he cut off the chief baker's head. I didn't tell you about his dream. His dream was a little different. The outcome was definitely different. And in his dream, his outcome wasn't as good as what happened with the butler. So Pharaoh cut off the baker's head, impaled his body, which that was the hanging. Impaled him on a rod. It was not like the nukes that we generally, they cut your head off, then they impaled you on a stake to as you were executed. The baker's fate was deplorable. But here it is, that what Joseph said would come to pass came to pass in 3 days in the future. But here's one thing that happened, and I don't take anything from Joseph for this, but it gives us a glimpse into what's going on in his heart. And then there's something else that's there too. Those guys didn't end up in that prison by mistake. Or let's say those guys didn't get in that prison in such a way that God was not able to make something happen from it. We know that Joseph was dead, but here's the prayer. When Joseph tells the butler about his dream, he says, "When you are restored, remember me. I was stolen from the land of the Hebrew. I've done no wrong to get here, nor since I've been here. Please make the plea." This is what he says. "Show kindness to me. Bring my case before Pharaoh." Joseph is simply asking for his kindness to be reciprocated with good reason. There's nothing wrong with asking, and it doesn't make his faith any less for asking. I think some things were beginning to open up to Joseph. I'm pretty close to Pharaoh right now. I'm pretty close to someone who can do something and make a difference in my life here on earth. I know the Lord is with me. He's been with me from the day I went to the pit, to the day I went to Potiphar's house, from Potiphar's house now to the prison. Now that I'm in the prison, I'm closer to Pharaoh. I can get there. I've been doing everything. In other words, Joseph is making a case. I've done nothing wrong to get here. I've done nothing wrong since I've been here. And so as I've done nothing wrong, make my case. And you know it is, you know how it is. It's all too typical for people to walk away without a thought from people whom they show kindness in their own time of need. And after their problem is solved, you don't see or hear from them ever again. Yeah, people are like that. The butler does come around, though. But here's the thing. There's another picture going on. There's God's time going on here. There's something happening in God's time. In God's time, providence in God's time means that God is working to bring about his will in his time. After 2 years pass, the Bible says, after 2 years, chapter 41, verse number 1, after 2 whole years, Pharaoh dreamed that he was standing by the Nile. Oh, the butler didn't say anything, but God may not have been ready. And as God was not ready, it wasn't anything that could take away from what Joseph was trying to do. Joseph's dreams were not deferred. Joseph's dreams were right on time. Joseph's dreams were over time. Joseph is now moving into his 20s, into his mid-20s. He's moving to a point where he's growing up to be a man. But in that process, God is making him ready because God wants him to lead in Egypt. And that will come. I don't know if I'm going to get through all this today, but I want to talk about the problem, and then we're going to maybe slow down on this just a little bit. So Joseph's prayer is, "Remember me." And you may not be remembered in someone else's prayer, but don't you ever believe for 1 minute that God has forgotten about you. He doesn't forget about us because someone else is not praying for us. As long as we continue to be diligent, as long as we continue to focus on the Lord, as long as we continue to do what's right in our space and in our time and wait on God in his time, in the spirit of humility, God, the Lord, is with us, and God will be with us, and God will get us through whatever we're going through. So it is, as there is this notion of, you know, the prison and the prisoners that are in the prison. Then as Joseph tells them about their dreams and they understand what's happening in their dream, Joseph made the prayer to the butler. And as he made the prayer to the butler, you know, God is just not ready. God is moving and acting and acting, but he's just not ready. And then there's the problem. The problem in the court of Pharaoh. And here's the problem. Pharaoh has two dreams in the same night. Two dreams of the first case, the first situation, it was two people having two dreams in one night. Now it's Pharaoh having two dreams in the same night. They were vivid, as clearly conveyed as the message and the meaning of Pharaoh needed to be understood. He talks about the 7 cows and the gaunt, the fat and the skinny and the fat coming up out of the Nile. They stood by the other cows on the bank. And the Bible says, "And the gaunt and the thin cows ate up the 7 sleek, fat cows. And Pharaoh awoke, and he fell asleep and dreamed a second time. And behold, 7 ears of grain, plump and good, were growing on one stalk. And behold," and you know, that's the word "behold." And behold, behold, behold. Oh, it was very clear to Pharaoh something's going on that he's not really understanding and is not used to. And you know, the beauty of it all is that this is Pharaoh's dream. But you got to wonder, is God moving behind the scenes? Is God having a way to speak to Pharaoh through his dreams? And understand that it's not for Pharaoh to understand and know what God is saying. Joseph, who is the prophet of God, whom God sends that will give him the message that comes from Pharaoh's mouth. And when he tells Pharaoh's mouth, out of Pharaoh's mouth, Pharaoh will be saying what God wants him to do. So it is. We have to understand it that way. That's the problem. Pharaoh, he's in his bed dreaming, and in his dreams he waked up. He doesn't understand. Fat cows, skinny cows, long grain, good grain, one eating up. And you know, when the skinny cows eat the fat cows, they don't gain any weight. They don't change. They don't look any different. Matter of fact, they're looking a bit worse. And so I need somebody to understand and help me how to get through understanding this dream. So what does he do? He calls all of his court together. Everybody come together now. I need the wise men. I need the magicians. I need everybody in here who can understand what's going on. You ever do that after you wake up from dreaming? Let me not stay there too long. The one element of these dreams that no man has the ability to know is the future. Because only God knows the future. The events in the dreams were set in the future. And only God not only knows the future, he's the only one that can make it happen, especially when it comes to fat cows and skinny cows and grain. Oh, yes. What does Joseph know? And you just gotta love Joseph, you know, as he talks about it. Verse chapter 41, verse 16, Joseph talks about it. Joseph says in verse 16, Joseph answered, you know, he summons him, and Joseph answered him, Pharaoh, it's not in me. It's not in me to give you the interpretation of the dream. He says, I've heard it said of you, when you hear a dream, you can interpret it. And Joseph answered Pharaoh, it's not in me. God will give Pharaoh a favorable answer. Who will give him an answer? God will give him an answer. It's very interesting that, you know, it's not me, it's God. Let me get through this. Let me just lay this out. And so, as the butler remembers, Pharaoh calls the Hebrew, brings Joseph in, and Joseph begins to tell him about the plan. And I'm going to get into the plan later on. I'm not going to do that today, but I just want you to understand that behind the scenes, God is moving. Dreams deferred, dreams delayed, dreams put off, because they need someone to help them to see, because they are not what they're dreaming for themselves. They are dreaming the message that God wants to send to Pharaoh. And as God sends the message to Pharaoh, Pharaoh's going to have to take some action. And when Pharaoh takes action, then we'll know that God is continuing to move in his life. I just want to wrap this up real quick. I'm going to come back to this later on, but understand this. Proverbs 21 and 1. The king's heart is in God's hand, like the rivers of water. He turns where he wishes. Oh, men think they're running things, but they are running anything. God is in control. God is in control. And as I know God is in control, my heart can be at ease. My mind, my spirit, my soul, everything can be at ease. I need to learn to walk with the Lord in humility of heart, resting my heart and my mind in Jesus. So it is. We'll leave it right there for right now. So it is. We have to appreciate the Lord for who he is and what he can do. He can move and you may not even see him, but you'll be saying what he needs you to say, doing what he needs you to do, being what he needs you to be, becoming who he wants you to become. If we just understand that we can hold on to God because of his providence that works in the affairs of our lives. If you need Jesus in your life today, we can come to him by faith. Without faith, it is impossible to please him. For he that cometh to God must believe that he is, and that he rewards them who seek him. We need to know that faith is the answer to all of our problems when it comes to trusting in the Lord and trusting him to get us through our problems that we face. But the most impressing one is that we become Christians. knowing that Jesus died for our sins, was buried and resurrected, accepting that to be fact and true, knowing that to be the way that I'm going to be able to live and get through this life successfully to get to the life to come, accepting Jesus as my Lord and Savior, confessing him to be the Son of God, then being buried with him in the waters of baptism for the remission of my sins, allowing him to take me in to be a part of his family and his covenant mercy and grace. And in that process, I become a Christian. He doesn't tell us to put our hand on the television. He doesn't tell us to pray the sinner's prayer. He tells us to come by faith, repentance, confession, and baptism, and to be buried in the waters of baptism for the remission, the remittal of our sins. And he adds us to the body of Christ just like a newborn baby born into a family. Nothing you can do about it if you come God's way. And when you come God's way, he will lift you up. He will keep you up. He will send you on your way. He will give you blessings along the way. And as he does, you will be a witness and a testimony to him in this world that men and women may need to see and know that God lives and moves and breathes and has his very, very, very being in me. So it is. Let's be contemplative for those of us who need prayer. We can pray with you and pray for you. Put your prayer request in the chat box. And let us pray with you. I don't know what they'll be, but I'll say it right now. We'll just pray with you and pray for you. And we pray that God will bless you in every way.
Restore my spirit, Lord, I need restore. My heart is weary, please help me, dear Lord. I stand in need of more strength from your word. Renew my love, rebuild my faith, oh, restore my soul. Revive the fire, Lord, deep in my soul. Stir my desire to work in your fold. Light in my heart, dear God, your zeal grown cold. Renew my love, rebuild my faith, oh, restore my soul. Renew my courage, Lord, it needs restore. My cup is empty, refill it, dear Lord. Replace all doubts and fears with faith so bold. Renew my love, rebuild my faith, oh, restore my soul.
Let us pray. Lord, we're thankful to you for every blessing and every gift of life. May our hope in you be sustained and strengthened. May our dependence on you come into its fullness in our material well-being as well as our spiritual well-being. Help us to forgive those who sinned against us, and help us to help them to forgive us for the sins we've trespassed against them. We pray, Father, for the oneness of your spirit in our hearts. May we all be aligned with you, only you, because you are the one and only true God. Thank you for Jesus, our Savior, and the Spirit who abides with us, who brings us comfort and understanding, that we may understand the peace that passes all understanding. Forgive us of our sins, enable us to be empowered, strengthened in the walk and in the knowledge of your word. Let it be a lamp unto our feet. Let us be encouragement to one another. Let us live to the glory and grace of God in every way and the ways that you prescribe. Praise be the Lord for all of your gifts and your blessings for us. May your mercy and kindness touch those who need you in the parting of their sins. May the souls of men everywhere learn to come penitently, humbly before you, bowing our heads, receiving the blessing that only you can give. Thank you, Lord, for every blessing and every gift. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
There is beyond the azure blue a God concealed from human sight. He tints the skies with heavenly hues and framed the world with his great might. There is a God, he is alive. In him we live and we survive. From dust our God created man. He is our God, the great I
prophets heard. He is the God that we should know, who speaks from his inspired word. There is a God, he is alive, in him we live, and we survive. From dust our God created man, he is our God, the great I am. Our God, who saw upon the tree, the life was willing that to give, that he from sin might set man free, and evermore with him could live. There is a God, he is alive, in him we live, and we survive. From dust our God created man, he is our God, the great I am.
For our closing scripture, I'd like to read from the 105th division of Psalms, verses 3 through 5 for our benediction. The 105th division of Psalms, verses 3 through 5. Glory in his holy name. Let the hearts of those rejoice who seek the Lord. Seek the Lord and his strength. Seek his face evermore. Remember his marvelous works which he has done, his wonders and the judgments of his mouth. Amen.
Good morning, church. Welcome this morning. Our invocation will be read from Psalms 100, verses 1 through 5. That is Psalms 100, verses 1 through 5, and it reads, Shout for joy to the Lord of all the earth. Worship the Lord with gladness. Come before him with joyful songs. Know that the Lord is God. It is he who made us, and we are his. We are his people of the sheep of the pasture. Enter his gates with thanksgiving, and his courts with praise. Give thanks to him and praise his name. For the Lord is good, and his love endures forever. His faithfulness continues through all generations. Bow for prayer, please. Heavenly Father, we thank you so very much for this day, that we can come and commune with you, so that we can hear your word to improve our lives. We thank you for all the blessings that you give us each and every day, and that you look out for us and you help us through our challenges and sickness. We give thanks that you will bless this church, bless our visitors, bless all those who are interested in your word, and bring them to us. Thank you, Heavenly Father. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
There's a message true and glad for the sinful and the sad. Ring it out, ring it out. It will give them courage new. It will help them to be true. Ring it out, ring it out. Ring out the word o'er land and sea. Still far from Jesus, many live in sin and doubt. Ring out the word that makes men free. To all the lost of every nation, ring it out. Tell the world of saving grace, make it known in every place. Ring it out, ring it out. Help the needy ones to know Him from whom all blessings flow. Ring it out, ring it out, ring out the word, o'er land and sea. Still far from Jesus, many live in sin and doubt. Ring out the news that makes men free. To all the lost of every nation, ring it, ring it out. Sin and doubt to sweep away, till shall dawn the better day. Ring it out, ring it out, till the sinful world be won, for Jehovah's mighty Son. Ring it out, ring it out, ring out the word, o'er land and sea. Still far from Jesus, many live in sin and doubt. Ring out the news that makes men free. To all the lost of every nation, ring it out. Ring out the word, o'er land and sea. Still far from Jesus, many live in sin and doubt. Ring out the news that makes men free. To all the lost of every nation, ring it out. Amen. Our next selection is 699. I'll Be a Friend to Jesus. If we have it, let us all together sing. They tried my Lord and Master, with no one to live, no one to defend. Within the halls, within the halls of highness, he stood without, he stood without a friend. I'll be a friend to Jesus.
My life for him.
My life for him I'll spend.
I'll be a friend
to Jesus.
Until my
years shall end. The world may turn against him. I'll love him to the end. And while on earth I'm living, my Lord shall have a friend.
Yes, Lord.
I'll be a friend to Jesus.
My life for him.
My life for him
I'll spend.
I'll be a friend to Jesus.
Until
my years shall end. To all who need a Savior, my friend, I recommend.
because he brought, salvation is why I am, his friend. Yes, Lord,
I'll be a friend to Jesus,
my life for him I'll spend.
I'll be a friend
to Jesus until my year, shall be. Amen.
Good morning, church. I am here before you with today's scripture reading and prayer. Today's scripture will be taken from Genesis chapter 40, verses 1 through 8, where the Bible reads, "Sometime after this, the butler of the king of Egypt and his baker offended their lord, the king of Egypt. And Pharaoh was angry with his two officers, the chief butler and the chief baker, and he put them in custody in the house of the captain of the guard, in the prison where Joseph was confined. The captain of the guard charged Joseph with them, and he waited on them. And they continued for some time in custody. And one night they both dreamed. The butler and the baker of the king of Egypt, who were confined in the prison, each his own dream, and each dream with its own meaning. When Joseph came to them in the morning and saw them, they were troubled. So he asked Pharaoh's officers who were with him in custody in his master's house, 'Why are your faces downcast today?' They said to him, 'We have had dreams, and there is no one to interpret them.' And Joseph said to them, 'Do not interpretations belong to God? Tell them to me, I pray you.'" May the Lord add a blessing to the hearers, the believers, and the doers of his word. And may you bow with me now for a word of prayer. Holy Father of God, we come before you humbly approaching your throne, thanking you for all that you have created, thanking you for each and every opportunity that you've given us to come before you with worship and with praise. Father, we just pray that you be with each and every one of us, that we be united together in worship, and though we be separated at this time. We pray that you will bless us so that your spirit will come to each of us and that you will be with us, Father God, as we worship and praise you. Father, we pray that you be with Leonard Bradley and his family. We pray that you bless him and his wife, his children. We pray that you be over his home and that you be over him and his life, that you bless him and all that he does, that he will continue to lead this congregation. Father, we pray that you bless the word that has been given to him, that he will deliver it into us in a way where we can understand it. We pray that you will open our hearts and our minds, that we will accept your word and that we will apply it to our lives. Father, we just pray that your word will forever change us every time we hear it and every time we accept it. Father, we just pray that you be with all those who have contracted coronavirus and the many families that have been affected by it. We pray that you continue to be with those who are administering the vaccine. We pray that you will bless us so that we can come out of this pandemic. We pray that you will continue to be a protector, a provider, and that you will continue to bless us so that we will do your will. Forgive us for our sins and our shortcomings and the things that we do which are contrary to your will and your way. Father God, just bless us this day and bless this worship, that all things which are done and said will be done in a manner pleasing and acceptable unto you. For it's in Jesus Christ's name we pray and thank you. Amen.
We will glorify the King of Kings. We will glorify the Lamb. We will glorify the Lord of Lords, who is the great I Am. Lord Jehovah reigns in majesty. We will bow before his throne. We will worship him in righteousness. We will worship him alone. He is Lord of heaven, Lord of earth. He is Lord of all who live. He is Lord above the universe. All praise to him we give. Oh, hallelujah to the King of Kings. Hallelujah to the Lamb. Hallelujah to the Lord of Lords, who is the great I am.
God said his Son, they call him Jesus. He came to love, heal and forgive. He lived and died to buy my pardon. An empty grave is there to prove my Savior lives. Because he lives, I can face tomorrow. Because he lives, all fear is gone. Because I know he holds the future, and life is worth the living just because he lives. How sweet to hold a newborn baby and feel the pride and joy he brings. But greater still, the calm assurance this child can face what's to delay because he lives. Because he lives, I can face tomorrow. Because he lives, all fear is gone. Because I know, oh, he holds the future, and life is worth the living just because he lives. And then one day, I'll cross the river, I'll fight my the woe and pain, and then as death gives way to victory, I'll see the light of glory and I'll know he lives. Because he lives, I can face tomorrow. Because he lives, all fear is gone. Because I know, oh, he holds the future, and life is worth the living just because he lives.
We come now to the portion of the service known as the communion. The communion is inextricably tied to the gospel. The historical facts are that the perfect God created man. Man sinned by disobedience in the garden and became exceedingly more sinful until the fullness of time that the Word of God came to earth as a man and was crucified for our sins, bearing our sins in his home body. Our perfect Lord and Savior loved us so much that he became the antithesis of his very existence in order to save us. We commemorate the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ by the symbols that he gave us the night that he was betrayed by Judas. The bread, representing the broken body, the cup, representing the blood that he spilled on the cross, establishing the covenant of grace and truth to all who believe. Shall we bow? Dear God, we understand that your word carried out your will in the creation and carried out your will in providing salvation to mankind. I pray that we realize the tremendous sacrifice that you made on our behalf and receive these symbols with the reverence due our Lord and Savior. It is in his name we pray. Amen.
And then one day, across the river, I'll fight my fight, woe and pain. And then as death gives way to victory, I'll see the light of glory and I'll know he reigns.
We come now to the portion of the service known as the contribution. Returning a portion of our prosperity to God, we know has been a part of our existence since Cain and Abel. Abraham's gift to Melchizedek exemplified the practice of giving one-tenth of one's prosperity that was codified in the law of Moses. We, having much better promises for salvation, are commanded by Christ and the apostles to give as we prosper. Please search your hearts and give back to the Lord a portion of your prosperity. Shall we bow? Most high and holy God in heaven, we pray that you please bless this collection that we have taken up. Dear God, bless the hands of those who will be administering these funds, that they do so in all ways pleasing and acceptable to you, and that the result of their efforts will be an increase in the spread of your word, an increase in the edification of the saints. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Let us sing. There's not a friend like the lowly Jesus, singing, oh, not one, no, not one, and none else could heal all our souls' diseases, singing, oh, not one, no, not one. I'll tell you, Jesus knows all about our struggles, and he will guide till the day is done. And there's not a friend like the lowly Jesus, singing, oh, not one, no, not one, and no friend like him is so high and holy, singing, no, not one, singing, no, not one, and yet no friend is so meek and lowly, singing, no, not one, oh, no, not one, and Jesus knows all about our struggles, and he will guide till the day is done, and there's
not a friend like the lowly Jesus. Singing, no, not one. Singing, no, not one. And there's not an hour that he is not near us. Singing, no, not one. Oh, no, not one. And no night so dark but his love can cheer us. Singing, no, not one. Singing, no, not one. I'll tell you, Jesus knows all about our struggles, and he will guide till the day is done. And there's not a friend like the lowly Jesus. Singing, no, not one. Oh, no, not one.
Good morning, Cypress family. We are so thankful to you and thankful to the Lord for bringing us together in this service today. As we move through this new year, 2021, we are blessed and we thank God for all of his goodness and grace towards us, for the blessings he's bestowed on us. And we pray that he continues to bless your lives. We are hoping that all is well with you and your families here at Cypress and across the country and other places where those of you who are joining in to be with us, we're grateful to welcome you and to have you in with us on this Lord's Day morning. We want to focus again in the book of Genesis. We're working through the life of Joseph. And the study is a fascinating study in so many ways. I just want to begin to focus today in Genesis chapter 40. We came through chapter 39 in our last message. This time, we want to focus in chapter 40. We may get into parts of 41. The paragraphs are so extensive, but they cover relevant information, important information. And I'm praying that all of us will be able to benefit and to gain what we need to understand in order for the Lord to be more effectively working in our own personal lives. And so if you will, join with me in Genesis chapter 40. We'll read to verse number 7, and then we'll launch into our message for today. Sometime after this, the butler of the king of Egypt and his baker offended their lord, the king of Egypt, and Pharaoh was angry with his two officers, the chief butler and the chief baker. And he put them in custody in the house of the captain of the guard, in the prison where Joseph was confined. The captain of the guard charged Joseph with them, and he waited on them, and they continued for some time in custody. And one night they both dreamed, the butler and the baker, of the king of Egypt, who were confined in the prison, each his own dream, and each dream with its own meaning. When Joseph came to them in the morning and saw them, they were troubled. And so he asked Pharaoh's officers, who were with him in custody in the master's house, why are your faces downcast today? They said to him, we have had dreams, and there is no one to interpret them. And Joseph said to them, do not interpretations belong to God? Tell me, I pray you. And so from this paragraph or this portion of scripture, I want to use for a topic, dreams of leaders deferred. Dreams of leaders deferred. deferred because, as we read in our story, the butler and the baker were downhearted. Their hearts were down. They were troubled. They were sorry because, as the text says, there is no one to interpret our dreams, which meant that they were not going to be able to get an understanding of what the dreams meant. Obviously, they were understanding that those dreams had some kind of meaning in their lives. But as they understood those dreams having meaning in their lives, they needed someone to tell them what they meant. And being in prison, of course, you can't get out into the country or out into the city to find someone who can help you with that in that time. So they were downcast. But Joseph, who he was, made the difference in that he was very attentive to their needs, as he had been, as we learned even here, that he waited on them. And we'll talk about that in a minute. But nonetheless, Joseph was there. And as Joseph was there, he understood that he had an inroad and an opportunity to open up this door to tell them what their dreams were all about. And remember, his motive is simply to pick up their spirits. But let's get into the thought. And I want to just put this out there in the beginning, and I'll say this as a guiding idea. I want us to see what's happening here. And in these stories, in these verses, I want to say that the power of God's providence is at work in our lives to bring about his will in our lives. The ability to know that God is present in your life requires careful submission in faith to the spirit of humility. Humility opens the heart to service and care for others at self-expense. I don't know that there's another character in this story that displays humility like Joseph. But humility is also the path where patience and perseverance find their strength to see God move in a disciplined life. Joseph lived a disciplined life, focused on no more than being faithful to the Lord, as the Lord was faithful to him. And there is no greater probability of success than to know the Lord and to lift him up in your life with every opportunity as you serve others in the process. And so I want to just talk just a bit, a moment, understanding that idea of providence, dreams of leaders deferred. The presence and providence of the Lord is significant in these verses, in this story. And the very interesting thing is that God is generally in the picture, but he's one of those pictures, you know, like how you have to stare at for a time in a certain way, and then after you stare at them for so long in a certain way, another image begins to appear, and you see that image there, and you say, oh, there's some depth to what's going on here. And so it is, even in this story with Joseph. There's some depth going on, and God is in the scene, in the picture, because providence means that he is actively engaged in human affairs, sovereignly engaged, over it all, not really interfering, but leaving everyone with their own decisions to make. And so as we think about this providence idea, when we started the series, Joseph in 37 and 5:11, Joseph considered the meaning of his dreams and what they would mean for his life. Now he has progressed to where he interprets dreams of others at the appropriate time. In this case, the dreamers are leaders who are anxious to know what they have dreamed made known to them. Through these events, we continue to see how God is openly at work in the world to bring his plans to life for man. He is sovereign, meaning that he is the Lord. He is
King of kings. He is over all, doing what he will in the interest of his creation without interfering with the choices and decisions we make for ourselves. Very important that God leaves us to be free human agents to make choices. But he also has choices that he would like for us to make, that he will not interfere with us because he loves us and he wants us to love him in return. But that said, understand, whatever the Lord pleases, as the psalmist says in Psalm 135 and 5, whatever the Lord pleases, he does in heaven and on earth, in the seas and all deeps. Daniel 4:35, later on, and Daniel, of course, looking at Nebuchadnezzar, but Nebuchadnezzar spoke giving praise and glory to God in this way, saying he lives forever, for his dominion is an everlasting dominion, and his kingdom endures from generation to generation. All the inhabitants of the earth are accounted as nothing, and he does according to his will in the host of heaven and among the inhabitants of the earth, and none can stay his hand or say to him, what are you doing? Joseph was good about putting others first. It was a quality that he had in his character. It helped get him into conversation with the butler and the baker who were put in the same prison, mind you, placed in the same prison where Joseph was being held. We look to see where we can find God moving in the lives of these leaders. Just so happens that the butler and the baker were, of course, servants in the court of Pharaoh. They were two high officers thrown in prison because they offended the king. The chief butler and the chief baker of Pharaoh's court are thrown with Joseph. And Joseph, the Bible says in 40 in verse number 1, and he put them in custody of the house of the captain of the guard in the prison where Joseph was confined. And the captain charged Joseph with them, and he waited on them, and they continued for some time in custody. So he had time to spend time, to get to know them, to pay attention, to understand who they were. How does this happen? These two guys, officers in the king's court, they were over something. One was the cupbearer and one was the baker. But the cupbearer was the one who drank the wine, if you will, to make sure there was no poison in it for the king. I'll just leave it like that for right now. And the baker, of course, was someone who worked in the preparation for food for the king or Pharaoh. The chief butler and the baker are here. And in the Bible, we need to understand that as they meet Joseph, they have in this very same setting, the butler and the baker of the king confined, each had his own dream. Two dreams, one night. In this one night, these dreams were so vividly displayed for them that they were troubled the next day. And so here we find Joseph coming to their assistant and saying to them, let me hear. And as he does, he says, do not interpretations belong to God? Only Joseph would know such a thing. But in the Bible, God uses dreams to communicate with men, especially in the patriarch time. The Bible shows us two kinds of dreams. The first are the dreams which communicate a message from God. Genesis 20, 3 and 7, 1 Kings 3, 5, Matthew 1, 20. God was needing to speak and did speak, and he used the medium of dreams. And understand that this is just one of the ways that God communicates. And it was a way that he communicated then. He doesn't necessarily communicate the same way now, because he doesn't need to in the same way. I listened to the Hebrew writer. Let me just read this for you real quick as we plow through this idea of dreams. I don't want anyone to get confused about the notion. You know, there are some charlatans out there that believe that God is making them to see things and understand things through their dreams. And maybe messages do come through dreams, but they're not always the voice of God in the same way. Hear the Bible in Hebrews chapter 1, in many and various ways, God, in many and various ways, God spoke of old to our fathers by the prophets, but in these last days has spoken to us by a Son whom he appointed heir of all things. There's no need to try to find message in dreams that God is not intending for us to know. But in this story, we learn that these Egyptians, the butler and the baker, were perplexed about what it is that they dreamed, and they needed to know because their dream was deferred. And so here we understand. Second, there is another way, another kind of dream that comes. And that dream, those dreams are, there is an ordinary dream, occurrences in which the sleeper sees a connected series of pictures which corresponds to the events of everyday life. You know, I have dreams like that sometimes, but, you know, I don't necessarily make sense of it all, and I don't, you know, necessarily want to try to make sense of it all. Sometimes you just want them to go away. But nonetheless, here in this case, the dreamers needed an interpreter. And until they got the interpreter, they were distraught, they were saddened, they were disappointed. Without the interpreter, they could not see the meaning of their dreams. The two of them dreamt the same night, one the next, and on the next day, Joseph sees that they're down. And then Joseph leans in for them to tell him their dreams. And just understand Deuteronomy 13:1-5, Jeremiah 23:25-32. Understand that God warns us about dreams and how that we need to be careful about dreams. But in this sense, and I believe as we read Deuteronomy 13:1-5, we need to understand that in this sense, Joseph is serving as a prophet. Because he interprets what God has communicated in the dream of the baker and the butler. But there's something unique about their dreams. Their dreams are about something that has not happened yet and will take place in the future. And so, as we understand, if you know anything about God and you know anything about prophecy and dreams, refer to Deuteronomy 13:1-5. If you know anything about this understanding, then you know that the only one who knows the future is God himself. No wonder they can't understand what they're dreaming. And we'll find out that even Pharaoh, we'll talk about Pharaoh, we'll understand that even Pharaoh could not understand his dream. And all the magicians and all the men that he brought, the wise men that he brought into his court, could not tell him what his dream meant, because no man can predict the future. Only God understands the future. Only God knows what's ahead. Only God can see the end from the beginning and the beginning from the end, because he is sovereign Lord. So when we understand that, you know, there's nothing more that can bring you to a place of humility than to understand that you are powerless in the hands of a mighty and great and wonderful God. And so it is. God gave Joseph, the Bible says, the ability to interpret dreams. 40 in verse number 8, Genesis. Let me just get back there real quick. That's why Joseph says that. You know, it's beautiful that Joseph is keen enough to understand it. It's beautiful that Joseph doesn't try to take credit for himself to say something that, you know, God gave him to say. Do not interpretations belong to the Lord? 41 in verse number 12. He goes there even with Pharaoh. If we listen to him again, the Bible says, well, I don't want to get ahead of my story here, but I'm not sure I'm going to get through all this today, but we'll just hang on to that thought for just a minute. And so the butler's dream is this. He sees the whole process, and I'm going to summarize it. You know, the butler's dream, let me get back over here to this verse here. The butler's dream, you know, he sees this thing happen just right in front of him in his dream. And I guess you can wonder, you know, making wine is a process. You can't just throw wine together. If you want a good wine, you know, a savory wine, you know, one of them, you can roll around, you can breathe and roll around. I don't know about all that. Jesus made the best wine in the world, you know, out of a pot of water. Probably the best wine, didn't have to go through all that process either. But in this dream, the butler, You know, the wine taster, he's also the cupbearer. He's also a eunuch in some degree. You know, the official of the king's court. Just throwing it out there for those of you who are paying attention. And so we understand that here, verse 9, the butler told his dream to Joseph and said to him, in my dream, there was a vine before me. I don't want to read all that. The vine before me. And on the vine, there were three branches. As soon as it budded, its blossoms shot forth and the clusters ripened into grapes. And so he's telling us that he sees the process of winemaking in just a matter of seconds. That's what dreams do. Dreams take things and put them in different fashion. You know, so it looks real funny. We don't understand what's going on, but it's happening in the dream. It doesn't make sense in a lot of ways, but here it is. He sees the bud. He sees the branches. He sees the blossoms, ripened grape, gathered, pressed, poured in Pharaoh's cup. The cupbearer serves the wine to Pharaoh. And so he asked Joseph, well, now, the outcome of his dream, Joseph declares to him, he says, this is its interpretation. In the three branches are 3 days. There you have 3 days. Within 3 days, the days that are to come, it's a future picture. It hasn't happened, but it's coming. Within 3 days, Pharaoh will lift up your head and restore you to your office, and you shall place Pharaoh's cup in his hand, and as formerly when you were his butler. 14. So he tells him exactly what's going to happen. And so, you know, and as he tells him what's going to happen, so the dreams involve the events. The king, just to give you a little backdrop, you know, ancient kings, the birthday was a national holiday for the king. And they had celebrations. And when they had these celebrations, they used them for showing special kindness to certain prisoners and dealing with others severely. So they would show favor to one and deal severely with another. This was just something, you know, I'm throwing a birthday party, you know, show up at your own risk or show up at your own, your own blessing, one way or the other. But you had two guys in prison, the baker and the butler, or the butler and the baker, whichever way you want to put it, bees are there, but there they are. And as they are there, we understand the king's birthday, 40 and verse number 20, and Joseph's master took him and put him into the prison. No, I'm sorry, wrong verse. And on the third day, it says, on the third day, here's the interpretation, chapter 40, verse 20. And on the third day, which was Pharaoh's birthday, he made a feast for all of his servants and lifted up the head of the chief butler. So he lifts up the head of the chief butler and the head of the baker among his servants. There's a lot of wordplay going on. I don't have time to explain it all. There's a lot going on. But the baker and the butler are his servants. And it says in verse 21, he restored the chief butler to his butlership. So the butler gets restored, and he placed the cup in Pharaoh's hand, just like Joseph said. And it says, but he hanged the chief baker. And what that means is that he cut off the chief baker's head. I didn't tell you about his dream. His dream was a little different. The outcome was definitely different. And in his dream, his outcome wasn't as good as what happened with the butler. So Pharaoh cut off the baker's head, impaled his body, which that was the hanging. Impaled him on a rod. It was not like the noose that we generally, they cut your head off, then they impaled you on a stake to as you were executed. The baker's fate was deplorable. But here it is, that what Joseph said would come to pass came to pass in 3 days in the future. But here's one thing that happened, and I don't take anything from Joseph for this, but it gives us a glimpse into what's going on in his heart. And then there's something else that's there too. Those guys didn't end up in that prison by mistake. Or let's say those guys didn't get in that prison in such a way that God was not able to make something happen from it. We know that Joseph was dead, but here's the prayer. When Joseph tells the butler about his dream, he says, "When you are restored, remember me. I was stolen from the land of the Hebrew. I've done no wrong to get here, nor since I've been here. Please make the plea." This is what he says. "Show kindness to me. Bring my case before Pharaoh." Joseph is simply asking for his kindness to be reciprocated with good reason. There's nothing wrong with asking, and it doesn't make his faith any less for asking. I think some things were beginning to open up to Joseph. I'm pretty close to Pharaoh right now. I'm pretty close to someone who can do something and make a difference in my life here on earth. I know the Lord is with me. He's been with me from the day I went to the pit, to the day I went to Potiphar's house, from Potiphar's house now to the prison. Now that I'm in the prison, I'm closer to Pharaoh. I can get there. I've been doing everything. In other words, Joseph is making a case. I've done nothing wrong to get here. I've done nothing wrong since I've been here. And so as I've done nothing wrong, make my case. And you know it is, you know how it is. It's all too typical for people to walk away without a thought from people whom they show kindness in their own time of need. And after their problem is solved, you don't see or hear from them ever again. Yeah, people are like that. The butler does come around, though. But here's the thing, there's another picture going on. There's God's time going on here. There's something happening in God's time. In God's time, providence in God's time means that God is working to bring about his will in his time. After 2 years pass, the Bible says, after 2 years, chapter 41, verse number 1, after 2 whole years, Pharaoh dreamed that he was standing by the Nile. Oh, the butler didn't say anything, but God may not have been ready. And as God was not ready, it wasn't anything that could take away from what Joseph was trying to do. Joseph's dreams were not deferred. Joseph's dreams were right on time. Joseph's dreams were over time. Joseph is now moving into his 20s, into his mid-20s. He's moving to a point where he's growing up to be a man. But in that process, God is making him ready because God wants him to lead in Egypt. And that will come. I don't know if I'm going to get through all this today, but I want to talk about the problem, and then we're going to maybe slow down on this just a little bit. So Joseph's prayer is, "Remember me." And you may not be remembered in someone else's prayer, but don't you ever believe for 1 minute that God has forgotten about you. He doesn't forget about us because someone else is not praying for us. As long as we continue to be diligent, as long as we continue to focus on the Lord, as long as we continue to do what's right in our space and in our time and wait on God in his time, in the spirit of humility, God, the Lord, is with us, and God will be with us, and God will get us through whatever we're going through. So it is, as there is this notion of, you know, the prison and the prisoners that are in the prison. Then as Joseph tells them about their dreams and they understand what's happening in their dream, Joseph made the prayer to the butler. And as he made the prayer to the butler, you know, this is, God is just not ready. God is moving and acting and acting, but he's just not ready. And then there's the problem. The problem in the court of Pharaoh. And here's the problem. Pharaoh has two dreams in the same night. Two dreams of the first case, the first situation, it was two people having two dreams in one night. Now it's Pharaoh having two dreams in the same night. They were vivid, as clearly conveyed as the message and the meaning of Pharaoh needed to be understood. He talks about the seven cows and the gaunt, the fat and the skinny and the fat coming up out of the Nile. They stood by the other cows on the bank. And the Bible says, "And the gaunt and the thin cows ate up the seven sleek, fat cows. And Pharaoh awoke, and he fell asleep and dreamed a second time. And behold, 7 ears of grain, plump and good, were growing on one stalk. And behold," and you know, that's the word behold. "And behold, behold, behold." Oh, it was very clear to Pharaoh something's going on that he's not really understanding and is not used to. And you know, the beauty of it all is that this is Pharaoh's dream. But you got to wonder, is God moving behind the scenes? Is God having a way to speak to Pharaoh through his dreams? And understand that it's not for Pharaoh to understand and know what God is saying. Joseph, who is the prophet of God, whom God sends that will give him the message that comes from Pharaoh's mouth. And when he tells Pharaoh's mouth, out of Pharaoh's mouth, Pharaoh will be saying what God wants him to do. So it is. We have to understand it that way. That's the problem. Pharaoh, he's in his bed dreaming, and in his dreams he waked up. He doesn't understand. Fat cows, skinny cows, long grain, good grain, one eating up. And you know, when the skinny cows eat the fat cows, they don't gain any weight. They don't change. They don't look any different. Matter of fact, they're looking a bit worse. And so I need somebody to understand and help me how to get through understanding this dream. So what does he do? He calls all of his court together. Everybody come together now. I need the wise men. I need the magicians. I need everybody in here who can understand what's going on. You ever do that after you wake up from dreaming? And let me not stay there too long. The one element of these dreams that no man has the ability to know is the future. Because only God knows the future. The events in the dreams were set in the future. And only God not only knows the future, he's the only one that can make it happen, especially when it comes to fat cows and skinny cows and grain. Oh, yes. What does Joseph know? And you just gotta love Joseph, you know, as he talks about it. Verse chapter 41, verse 16, Joseph talks about it. Joseph says in verse 16, Joseph answered, you know, he summons him, and Joseph answered him, Pharaoh, it's not in me. It's not in me to give you the interpretation of the dream. He says, I've heard it said of you, when you hear a dream, you can interpret it. And Joseph answered Pharaoh, it's not in me. God will give Pharaoh a favorable answer. Who will give him an answer? God will give him an answer. It's very interesting that, you know, it's not me, it's God. Let me get through this. Let me just lay this out. And so as the butler remembers, he calls, Pharaoh calls the Hebrew, brings Joseph in, and Joseph begins to tell him about the plan. And I'm going to get into the plan later on. I'm not going to do that today, but I just want you to understand that behind the scenes, God is moving, dreams deferred. Dreams delayed, dreams put off because they need someone to help them to see, because they are not what they're dreaming for themselves. They are dreaming the message that God wants to send to Pharaoh. And as God sends the message to Pharaoh, Pharaoh's going to have to take some action. And when Pharaoh takes action, then we'll know that God is continuing to move in his life. I just want to wrap this up real quick. I'm going to come back to this later on, but understand this. Proverbs 21 and 1. The king's heart is in God's hand, like the rivers of water. He turns where he wishes. Oh, men think they're running things, but they are running anything. God is in control. God is in control. And as I know God is in control, my heart can be at ease. My mind, my spirit, my soul, everything can be at ease. I need to learn to walk with the Lord in humility of heart, resting my heart and my mind in Jesus. So it is. We'll leave it right there for right now. So it is. We have to appreciate the Lord for who he is and what he can do. He can move and you may not even see him, but you'll be saying what he needs you to say, doing what he needs you to do, being what he needs you to be, becoming who he wants you to become. If we just understand that we can hold on to God because of his providence that works in the affairs of our lives. If you need Jesus in your life today, we can come to him by faith. Without faith, it is impossible to please him. For he that cometh to God must believe that he is, and that he rewards them who seek him. We need to know that faith is the answer to all of our problems when it comes to trusting in the Lord and trusting him to get us through our problems that we face. But the most impressing one is that we become Christians. Knowing that Jesus died for our sins, was buried and resurrected, accepting that to be fact and true, knowing that to be the way that I'm going to be able to live and get through this life successfully to get to the life to come, accepting Jesus as my Lord and Savior, confessing him to be the Son of God, then being buried with him in the waters of baptism for the remission of my sins, allowing him to take me in to be a part of his family and his covenant mercy and grace. And in that process, I become a Christian. There's no, he doesn't tell us to put our hand on the television. He doesn't tell us to pray the sinner's prayer. He tells us to come by faith, repentance, confession, and baptism, and to be buried in the waters of baptism for the remission, the remittal of our sins. And he adds us to the body of Christ just like a newborn baby born into a family. Nothing you can do about it if you come God's way. And when you come God's way, he will lift you up. He will keep you up. He will send you on your way. He will give you blessings along the way. And as he does, you will be a witness and a testimony to him in this world that men and women may need to see and know that God lives and moves and breathes and has his very, very, very being in me. So it is. Let's be contemplative for those of us who need prayer. We can pray with you and pray for you. Put your prayer request in the chat box and let us pray with you. I don't know what they'll be, but I'll say it right now. We'll just pray with you and pray for you. And we pray that God will bless you in every way.
Restore my spirit, Lord, I need restore. My heart is weary, please help me, dear Lord. I stand in need of more strength from your word. Renew my love, rebuild my faith, oh, restore my soul. Revive the fire, Lord, deep in my soul. Stir my desire to work in your fold. Light in my heart, dear God, your zeal grown cold. Renew my love, rebuild my faith, oh, restore my soul. Renew my courage, Lord, it needs restore. My cup is empty, refill it, dear Lord. Replace all doubts and fears with faith so bold. Renew my love, rebuild my faith, oh, restore my soul.
Let us pray. Lord, we're thankful to you for every blessing and every gift of life. May our hope in you be sustained and strengthened. May our dependence on you come into its fullness in our material well-being as well as our spiritual well-being. Help us to forgive those who sinned against us, and help us to forgive those, help them to forgive us for the sins we've trespassed against them. We pray, Father, for the oneness of your spirit in our hearts. May we all be aligned with you, only you, because you are the one and only true God. Thank you for Jesus, our Savior, and the Spirit who abides with us, who brings us comfort and understanding, that we may understand the peace that passes all understanding. Forgive us of our sins. Enable us to be empowered, strengthened in the walk and in the knowledge of your word. Let it be a lamp unto our feet. Let us be encouragement to one another. Let us live to the glory and grace of God in every way and the ways that you prescribe. Praise be the Lord for all of your gifts and your blessings for us. May your mercy and kindness touch those who need you in the parting of their sins. May the souls of men everywhere learn to come penitently, humbly before you, bowing our heads, receiving the blessing that only you can give. Thank you, Lord, for every blessing and every gift. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
There is beyond the azure blue a God concealed from human sight. He tints his skies with heavenly hues and framed the world with his great might. There is a God, he is alive, in him we live, and we survive. From dust our God created man, he is our God, the great I
Lord, whose voice the prophets heard. He is the God that we should know, who speaks from his inspired word. There is a God, he is alive, in him we live, and we survive. From dust our God created man, he is our God, the great I am. Our God, who sat upon a tree, the life was willing that to give, that he from sin might set man free, and evermore with him could live. There is a God, he is alive, in him we live, and we survive. From dust our God created man, he is our God, the great I am.
For our closing scripture, I'd like to read from the 105th division of Psalms, verses 3 through 5 for our benediction. The 105th division of Psalms, verses 3 through 5. Glory in his holy name. Let the hearts of those rejoice who seek the Lord. Seek the Lord and his strength. Seek his face evermore. Remember his marvelous works which he has done, his wonders and the judgments of his mouth. Amen.